We gotta know our heritage, for one thing, right? Really fantastic what the Greeks and Romans accomplished. How do you build a reliable worldview from scratch? How do we know our particular pieces of these worldviews are correct and not someone else's? Live that self-examined life.
For those who think beyond boundaries, where is your pride? What's up, everybody? Arael Avinu here with Fully Deconverted. Sorry, we're starting a little late there. We're about 10 minutes late, something like that. Anyways, totally worth it because we got on Hector Garcia, author of Alphagod. And if you didn't see our first interview, I will tag it in the description after this. But today we are talking about sexual dominance from apes to men to gods. And who doesn't want to learn about that? All right, so let's bring Hector on. What's going on, Hect? Can I call you Hect?
Sure, call me Hect, man. How are you? Good to see you again.
Good to see you again. I'm totally not going to call you Hector.
Don't call me Hect.
I will call you Hector, yeah. Bam, bam. All right.
Yeah.
Hector, as usual, I love reading your book, mostly because I've simply never heard this before. You know, as a former Christian growing, like, you just don't hear it from this angle. And to everybody watching, you're probably going to love this episode, especially if you're religious. If you're religious, do not tune out. Tune in. Anyways, Hector, this is on sexual dominance from apes to men to gods. And what can you give us, like, a one-liner overview of what this is about before we jump right into it?
I don't think I can do a one-liner, but I'll do a short one. Why is an all-powerful being so interested in human sex? That's the question that this chapter seeks to answer.
Bam, there we go. So in your book, you talk about religious sexual repression and religiously motivated violence against women. What's the point of your saying so? Like, how does that factor into the Christian God and women and sex? Where are we coming up with terms like religious sexual repression and motivated violence?
Oh boy, the history of those things, the history of sexual oppression, the history of sexual violence. I mean, I think taking a step back. I mean, so as a non-believer, as we talked about last time, I never was a believer. It seems really intuitive and clear to me that of course the creator of the universe does not care about who inserts what into whom on this little speck of dust that Earth is relative to the rest of the universe. Of course not.
Yeah, of course not to you. Yeah.
Yeah. So for you know, those among your viewers are believers, I think it's important to point out why it's so important to us, why sexual behavior is so of interest to us, why it consumes so much of our moral psychology, because we are sexually reproducing beings. Mm. Our genetic fitness, how much we can project our own or reproduce our own genetic material into future generations, is based on the sexual behavior of other humans and of ourselves. So it has enormous consequence for us. But again, an all-powerful being that doesn't need to replicate himself into the future to avoid rotting into the earth like we do shouldn't really care. But in the Bible, in the Quran, in so many other religious scriptures, you know, gods are described as being really interested in human sex. And so if we want to understand why, if we want to understand that incongruity, again, just like we did last time, just like we talked about last time, you have to deconstruct the model. Why does it matter to us? How does it get projected onto the gods that we create?
Okay, then Hector, let's do that then. And let's start with apes. This chapter is Apes to Men to Gods, okay? So maybe for a lot of our viewers and anybody unfamiliar with your work, they're not going to be able to make that leap so kind of organically. So let's take them on a short experience by talking about apes first. And I want to premise this by saying, if people don't already think it, believe it, or otherwise, the premise here is that we are all primates. We come from apes or are apes or whatever. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay.
That is absolutely correct. We are one species of great ape that managed to emigrate from Africa and populate the world. Yeah. And so I think to understand, again, the subtitle is The Psychology of Religious Violence and Oppression. To understand that, I think you have to understand a couple things about mating strategy. And It's important to talk about this, Arael, because it informs so much of our religious behavior, of our social and political behavior, but it's usually unconscious. We're not aware of all these motivations in our day-to-day lives. So if you look at males and females across many, many species, including us, generally speaking, males and females enact different kinds of strategies. So men, for example, it's a number strategy. Our genetic fitness, how much we can reproduce, is based on how much we can copulate. So men are far more interested in numbers than women are, and this is a robust finding that has been seen across the world, across every political structure, across every religion, across SES. And again, like we talked about last time, this is not to say that just because, you know, we have a tendency for something, it's not set in stone. We can choose to behave differently. In general, men tend to prefer numbers. Women tend to prefer quality. Yeah. Why? Because men and women bring different resources to the reproductive game. Men produce 1.5 million sperm in one ejaculation.
Yeah.
You know, we have that to spare. Men can theoretically have 1,000 children. I think the record is 1,000 children or 800 children.
I did not know that.
Ismael the bloodthirsty, and this is going to be relevant later because, you know, usually men achieve that sort of reproductive fitness through violent means by competing with other males. But if I can just lay the groundwork for you, so women, on the other hand, their reproductive output is vastly more limited. So 500 ova total throughout the whole lifespan, limited to adolescence, to menopause. And they tend to invest a great deal in offspring. Men can invest an ounce of sperm and walk away, theoretically. So women tend to be far more choosy. There's a mountain of research about this. One that I think you might find entertaining is a couple studies, that one that replicated the other, had attractive undergraduates who were Confederates, researchers posing as non-researchers, walk around campus, chat up somebody of the opposite sex, and quickly offer casual, no strings attached sex.
That sounds like normal college life.
Yeah. Well. Yeah, and perhaps
I don't think
you
needed researchers for that. You could have just polled people.
Right, but the interesting thing is that a whopping 75% of the men said, "Yeah, let's go right now. I'm down." You know, across both of these studies, do you know what percentage of women? Zero. Zero.
See that in your book. So, that was astounding.
Yeah. I mean, this is just one study out of so many that show this. So to use a concept from economics, when you have all this demand, when resources are scarce, you see competition. just like you would for food, just like you would for territory. Men compete for sex. Mm-hmm. Throughout our history, that has been violent competition. I mean, if you look at the history of warfare, one thing that is endemic to almost every campaign we've ever seen is wartime rape. Millions of women were raped during World War II. In Bosnia, in Rwanda, over and over and over and over. So we see that we see these patterns in great apes, right? So Hector, chimpanzees will.
Can I jump in right there? Okay, I just want to see if I can pick on this and if I'm right or in the right direction. Wartime rapes, is that because males are always in the sense of competition? So they see that as kind of a spoils of war and act on that opportunity with the competition eliminated to have sex with a woman. Am I in the general direction as you think the studies find?
Absolutely. So men, when in that situation, rape is incredibly easy, and it's only doesn't tend to happen when prohibition against rape is strongly enforced. You see this across, it's stunning how common that was. But to go back before then to the apes part of the apes men to God analogy is that you see this behavior in other primates. Males competing violently for reproductive access. More dominant males, the tougher males get more access to females. Chimpanzee troops will raid the rival tribe, kill all the males one by one, and absorb all the females into their troop.
Yeah,
we see this in men. It's scary, it's unpleasant, but we have to look at it.
And so we're using
not surprisingly
like that, looking at chimpanzees, and we're drawing the correlation between all of us being primates and apes. Saying like, there is a correlation here between how they operate and how we humans operate, and then
sure. Yeah. And again, we can choose to not abide by these impulses. I mean, there's always that choice. Not all men are wartime rapists. That's not where we're going here. But there is that propensity. So take for example, there's research looking at nations in which polygyny is practiced, where men can have multiple wives. Well, most societies are 50-50 male female, give or take. If one man has all the females, other men are going to be left out. In these societies, you see a much higher rate of revolutions. So what are revolutions? They're young men rising up, challenging the power structure. Now, these men aren't saying, I'm going to do this to get access to women, but when you have these pressures, these kinds of things happen.
Yeah.
Where does that leave us in respect to God? Well, take for example, in Numbers, Moses tells all his men, now kill all the boys and kill every woman who has ever slept with a man, and take the ones that haven't slept with a man for yourself. Ancient primate behavior, ostensibly commanded by God, who has male interests in mind. God telling Moses telling his men enacting this ancient primate pattern that we've seen across the course of our species history.
Well, I think it's very interesting when it does come to, you know, God talking to man and then these things playing out. I do want to talk about the apes a little bit more, but since we brought up, you know, the idea, the notion of when one man and many women and that whole sort of thing, I just want to be able to prime our audience with the video that we have ready for everybody of what that would actually look like. Hector, should we show our audience what it would actually
look
like?
Show that video. It's amazing. It's amazing.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, prepare to know what it's looked like, especially you men, if you actually got, I don't know what we wanted. I don't know. Let's check it out. Let's see what we got. Here we go.
Yeah.
Hector.
It's amazing. It's amazing. And I write about this particular clip in the book. You know, marketing executives have no problem with evolutionary psychology.
I bet they don't.
So what you saw was the demand. You saw the demand side of what we're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, there's this incredible demand. Women's reproductive resources are limited. Males will compete violently for those resources.
Yeah.
And the Bible, the Old Testament is full of references to wartime rape, with God saying, hey, this is what I want. This is what I want. I want you to go out and do this. Go ahead. I got your back. I got your back in all of this.
Yeah. And, you know, that guy right there in the commercial didn't have a problem at all. But, you know, so everybody go out and get whatever that spray was.
Right.
I should put a link in the description and get like some Amazon affiliate. I'm going to show that commercial like every time I do a show now and just put a link for that product and see if I make money off of that. We're going to see how well these
markets. Oh boy.
When we're trying to draw correlations for some of us that are still not convinced, Hector, about how humans operate and how other primates operate. Let's call on a scenario of Franz de Waal in a study that this person conducted. Can you tell us a little bit about who Franz de Waal is?
Yeah, he's a Dutch primatologist who studied studied the behaviors of chimpanzees. He's the author of an amazing book, Chimpanzee Politics, that just talks about all the machinations that you see between chimpanzees as they struggle for rank and they ally with one another to achieve rank and they deceive one another. A mirror into contemporary US politics, I think, and so many other things. But
yeah,
that's your friends to all this.
Yeah. So and this primatologist, you know, there's a note here in your book, and I'm just gonna read a quick sentence or two, and then we can start seeing how all this ties in together with apes, men, gods.
Yeah.
Franz de Waal says, it is not that high-ranking males are more virile, but that they are incredibly intolerant and chase lower-ranking. And we're talking about, are we talking about chimpanzees here, I think? Incredibly intolerant and chase away lower-ranking rivals away from estrus females. Am I saying that word right, estrus?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, okay. When females are in estrus, when they're reproductively viable.
Got you. If they catch another male mating, they intervene by attacking him or his mate. Females are also clearly aware of this risk. I just want to read that by that person so we can kind of keep that in mind, plant a flag right there as we continue our discussion. Can one example of chimp's behaviors be representative of other primates, or are you, Hector, or others, just grasping at straws when you draw these examples out and try to distinguish or make that correlation with humans?
So one strategy is acquiring numbers. Another strategy is deflecting rivals. I think one really important concept to understand that explains not only religious sexual oppression, but you know, why the political right in the U.S. in particular is so, just follows that lead and all the legislation around women's reproductive rights and things like that. Cuckoldry. Have you heard the term cuckoldry? So the term comes from the cuckoo bird. It's a species of bird that engages in this practice called brood parasitism. Mm. It's really kind of interesting to watch these nature documentaries about this, because what happens is the cuckoo bird will lay its eggs in another species' nest, often a much smaller species, and that bird will be suckered into raising the cuckoo bird's eggs. So often that bird hatches and forces the other eggs in the nest out.
Yeah.
And so he kills them. So the bird who gets duped has to spend all this energy and taking all these risks feeding another bird's offspring. Mm-hmm. So that is that the risk of being cuckolded, as it were, is something that is of great concern to males, and it comprises a lot of male reproductive psychology, especially men, because male human or human infants spend so much time in dependency. There's so much energy and resources that have to be devoted to a human infant.
Yeah.
Unlike other animals, human infants are squirming, mute little creatures that can't take care of themselves for years. So that what you don't want to do is be duped into raising a male's offspring. Women don't have to contend with this concern because they always know when an offspring is theirs. Mm. So what happens is that men mate guard. They do what other primates do, and that when their mate is fertile, they guard that mate. I mean, you know, so just like you were talking about when in other primates, when females are in estrus, that male stays right by her sides, chases off other rivals, and sometimes attacks the female if she flirts with or grooms other primates.
Yeah.
Well, men do the same thing. You know, spousal homicide, spousal violence is vastly disproportionately committed from jealous husbands to jealous wives. And it's usually sexual jealousy that's at the root of spousal homicide. So take that a step further, because men have historically made all the laws, the secular laws. And in many countries, until recently, it was legal to kill your wife if you found her in bed with another man. In Texas, as late as like 1972. Astounding. So that, you know, that addresses this fear of cuckoldry. You retaliate against a woman. Well, you know, needless to say, men are the ones who have written scripture for the vast majority of our religious history. And they've done so right, you know, with their own evolutionary interests in mind. So there's a lot of these dynamics in the Bible, for example.
Is this what we look like when we're writing those scriptures?
This is an example of two baboons fighting each other in mate competition. They're fighting each other for access to females.
Yeah.
What we talked about earlier is men doing in war. Yeah.
All right, go on about us writing scriptures and how that correlates with sexual repression and mate guarding.
So in Deuteronomy, there's this passage that goes something like, you know, if a virgin gets raped in a town and doesn't scream out loud enough, you kill her attacker and kill her too for not screaming out loud enough.
Right.
So it's that same primate behavior of punishing women for potentially straying. And in religion, there's all kinds of ways to prevent cuckoldry, you know, such as, you know, insisting on virginity, because virgins come guaranteed to be free from the rival's genes, right? If you're a virgin, you're not carrying another man's genes. There's all this fascination with virginity, certainly in Christianity and Islam and so many other religious traditions for that reason. Per Paul, Christ wants virgins for himself. So
that's kind of, so Hector, when we say this though, when we talk about a God and God wanting virgins for himself, like I feel like the connection to you is obvious, but it's not so obvious to the rest of us because we haven't placed these behaviors with anything sexual. Well, I mean, loosely, yes, when we start saying terms like chaste and, you know, save yourself or be pure. But a lot of these either act in place of another word that we're actually trying to use to accomplish something, or as a figure of speech to mean or refer to something else. How can we paint the picture a little bit more clearly about how, this really looks like God, scripture written by men, in other words, is meant to control our sexual behavior? How can we make this a little bit more clear? Because I'm just worried that this might go over a lot of people's heads, just like it would have mine even a year ago.
Right. So taking a step back, this fascination with virgins you see across the history of our species when there was no such thing as contraception, right? So the surest way to assure that your bride is not carrying another male's genes, which is would be a disaster for a man. A man who would have to spend all this energy rearing an offspring that isn't his, putting all this effort into another person's genetic material.
Yeah.
So virgin brides have been highly prized throughout our history as a species. So not surprisingly, you know, gods across religious traditions are purportedly interested in virgins. Krishna's mother was said to have been a virgin. Mary was said to have been a virgin. The Inca gods are devoted virgins into their service, but of course, you know, the men that represent them on Earth, they're the ones who get to enjoy them. And that's often been the case in this fascination with virgins.
Yeah. So then how did Christianity go to this? Sorry to interrupt the flow there, but you know, Christians are going to be watching this right now. They're going to be thinking, you know, if we tell everybody to be chaste though, or if we tell to be virgins until marriage or save yourself until marriage, or if you're not, you know, at least start now and that sort of thing, who's making out on this deal, Hector? Who's the alpha male in this case? And how did that even get created? Can we just punch that one real quick, because they're going to be like, no one's having sex with our women except for their future husbands, and if they don't, we're probably going to kick them out of the church anyways if they're openly promiscuous, as we know a lot of them are anyways in these new age churches. So I'm just saying.
Yeah, I wouldn't know, but I take your word for it. But you know, the thing is,
take my word for it.
The thing is, you know, the point is that God is saying that he wants virgins, you know.
God is saying
he's interested in this. He for himself. He's saying that he wants you to preserve your virginity. Look at what happens when women devote themselves in the Catholic tradition, devote themselves to God. They have to swear chastity.
Yes.
To their God. They give up sex with men so they can serve God better. This is all this very ancient primate legacy meant to ensure, there you go.
Yeah.
There you go. And you know, there's a difference in the emphasis on virginity in Islam. In Islam, it's God reserving virgins for men. In Christianity, it's more like God is reserving virgins for himself.
Yeah, why?
Exactly why. God shouldn't require these things, right? God is seen as a sexually jealous being. I mean, and he's very explicit about that, especially in the book of Revelations. All the horrors he perpetrates on the earth, you probably know those better than me. You know, flooding the earth with blood, turning the rivers and the oceans into blood, you know, burning people with the sun. Why did he do that? He did that because his wives, who were represented as the twin cities of Samaria and Jerusalem, were unfaithful to him.
Mm.
That's why he exacted this revenge, like a jealous husband bent on, you know, punishing his unfaithful spouse.
So let me read something from Revelations, just so we can make a connection since you just spoke about it. This is Revelations chapter 14, verse 4. These are they which were not defiled with women. We're talking about the 144,000, if I got any Revelation enthusiasts. The 144,000 should stand out to your mind. These are they who were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb wheresoever he goes. These were redeemed from among men, because the being the first fruits unto God and the Lamb. So Revelations 14, 4. For they are virgins. Why does God want other men to be virgins? And why do we see this in a Catholicism as well? Why is there emphasis being placed there?
Yeah. Well, I think I like to look at where we see these dynamics, these behaviors in nature. Mm. Where do you see sexual repression in nature? Mm. Well, typically, if you're talking about a group of social animals where there's a dominance hierarchy, you see it coming from the dominant individuals. Those that are dominated by males, it's the alpha male. So the alpha male is saying, none of you subordinates have sex. I reserve that for myself.
And we see that
sexual primacy. See that in other apes.
Yeah.
And you certainly see that, you know, in places where polygyny is allowed, when you have somebody who has enough wealth or power to make that happen, you know, he does. As the case with Ismail, the bloodthirsty has 800 wives, or his 800 children. I forget how many wives he had to produce that many children.
And who's that person again? Who are we talking about?
Ismail the bloodthirsty. He was this historical figure that won the Guinness Book of World Records for a number of offspring. And he earned that name, believe me. slaughtering all the men from the rival villages, mounting their heads on spikes and having it surround his palace. Wow. You know, so that's violent male mate competition, just like we see in other primates. But to answer your question, you know, so that is, it's illogical, right? Why would an all-powerful being care if his subordinates are chaste? Hmm. When this being could reproduce himself a billion times, when he can create a billion human beings with just a word, if he wasn't based on us, men are concerned about these things. Other primates, other species, other mammals are concerned about these things.
Yeah.
Because they impact our reproductive capacity.
So it just starts looking suspicious, in other words, when all of a sudden I'm the one trying to control my group here and create solidarity, and at the same time put forth my evolutionary needs and logic, and then I'm kind of like, you know what, everybody, God said stop having sex, all you men over here form a group, okay, you guys can't have sex anymore, we're gonna call you the Levites, or you know, the priests, and you guys are done, you're out of there, I need 20% over here, thank you. Looking good, ladies, you better not be having sex with men. Except for you over here, we're going to consecrate the virgins over here and make sure we're good. All right, numbers aren't looking good. Let's go to the next town over.
It serves the men. You know, that's the thing. Men write scripture to serve their own evolutionary interests. In the Quran, it says, good women are obedient. They guard their unseen parts because God has guarded them. They guard those parts from other males.
Yeah.
Right. And if the woman is disobedient, beat her and send her to bed. This is from the Quran. So you see mate guarding. So all this, oh boy. And this is Bibi Aisha. She's a young woman from Afghanistan who left her arranged marriage because her husband was abusive. So he, with the help of his, you know, his male relatives, cut off her nose.
Yeah.
In retaliation for leaving them. So it's mate guarding. You can't leave. In Saudi Arabia, women have male guardians. And if a woman tries to leave the country, the people at the airport send their male guardians a text to say, look, she's trying to leave. They have to get permission to leave from their male guardians. All of this, you know, this drapery that you see in the burqa is designed to prevent women from straying, you know, so that she won't be tempting to other males. Mm-hmm. You know, ultimately to prevent cuckoldry. You boil down all the dogma, all the cultural, and it boils down to this need for sexual primacy. Men who were not jealous at all in our evolutionary history, primates were not jealous at all. They didn't reproduce their genes. Those who were jealous reproduced their genes into future generations by guarding their females and making sure that they didn't reproduce with other men. It's the ugly math of evolution once again. But we can understand this. We can bring this to the surface and say, okay, all this male violence against women that gets solidified into religious scripture and practice. Where does this come from? You know, do we really need that? There's contraception now. You know, you don't have to worry about raising another man's child. You know, I guess the point is just to be thoughtful about where these things come from and say, does this still serve us? Do we still want to live by these most primitive of impulses? Do we want to give excessive privilege to one gender? What are the consequences of that? Well, the consequences of that are women can't vote. Women can't drive. You know, women, when they try to leave their abusive husband, you know, they get mutilated. When women walk around without covering, they get acid thrown on them. Mm-hmm. So the reason for that is very primitive. And that's what I'm, you know, it's a harsh reality to take in, you know, but that's, you know, the discomfort of looking at this is pales in comparison to the consequences of not being honest about it.
Yeah. And just to take that one step further, ladies and gentlemen, I know we're showing some what extreme examples here for our friends over in the Western United States, you know, with mate guarding and securing, you know, our own interests and stuff like that. But you dumb it down just a little bit or water it down. And even in your local Protestant church, you may have some abuse going on, something where somebody doesn't feel safe. And I've responded to all kinds of these as a former law enforcement officer and as a member in the church, in several churches. And often what is kind of the rhetoric that we defer to in moments where the man is abusing the wife and the wife is feeling uncertain, insecure, confused, unsafe, there might be some temporary relief of her situation, such as she goes and stays at a friend's house for a little bit, but she is encouraged to remain faithful to her husband, to go back, be obedient. The end game is reconciliation. And there's no real investigation into how chronic these problems are. The investigation goes like this: trust God. Okay, if he's going to kill you right now, get out of the house. But you need to have the goal of going back. Hector, we don't say this in anywhere else in our life unless we're in a religious circle who says your faithfulness is to your man. Because why? Man is the glory of God, and woman is the glory of man. Hector, I was wanting you to finish that for me.
You did well. You did well with that. You know, The body is not for fornication. It's for God. I mean, this, you know, women are not to, man is not to serve woman, woman is to serve man. I mean, you get these messages all over the place, but it's based on our reproductive psychology. And it's intuitive. Nobody usually thinks about where these things come from.
Right.
It's just part of the culture and people go with it. So we have to have these conversations to see if we really want that in our lives anymore. Does it serve us like it did when we were in Mesopotamia during the biblical age? That's the big question for, you know, I think that's what I'm trying to answer with all of this stuff.
Don't answer that just yet, Hector. Let's hit the pause button on how useful is it still, and let's head over to our live feed. Just say hello to everybody. What is up, everybody? What's up, Paxable? What's up, Trevor Lund? What's up, Morte? What's up, Evan Waddy? What's going on, everybody? Let me see what you guys got going on here. I'm going to pick a random comment. Here we go. Yahweh is greedy and isn't satisfied with being the Alpha. He wants to be all the levels down to including Omega. Clever. From our very own Trevor Lund. Funny guy. Morte, the old monogamy model spread sexual access to non-alpha males in exchange for reliable access to resources. Now she can access resources on her own, is free again to pursue her own instinct for alphas. Hector, tell us a little bit about maybe this spectrum where you don't have just an alpha male completely dominating, and I guess I'm talking more apes here, but that there is somehow a spectrum that we navigate through, and the alpha male just doesn't get everything. Is there such a thing as that spectrum?
Absolutely, absolutely. When we pay attention to that, when we design our societies so that there are checks and balances on power, you know, when there aren't checks and balances on power, men, as history has shown, are more than willing, you know, to assume that alpha position and become totalitarians. You know, mm-hmm. I think the very American experience that the founding fathers, you know, tried to enact was based on countering that. There's got to be checks and balances. You know, there's got to be checks on power. Otherwise, you see this.
Okay, so my question becomes, Hector, if this is kind of how we are evolutionarily, you know, I guess not all men want to be alpha in their day-to-day lives, right?
No. No.
But if we were to, hold on. But if we were to fantasize, Hector, we might be fantasizing about something like this, right? Let me get to where there's more of them. All right. All the straight guys out there, you're welcome for me replaying this. I mean, we've got women swimming across the water here. Look at them fighting. All right. So we might not in our day-to-day lives be alpha by behavior, but don't we fantasize about this right here, what we're looking at? All the women coming for us. And if that's what we're fantasizing about, so here's part two of the question. Look at this guy.
It's hilarious. It's hilarious.
It is, Hector.
And then it tops off with this spray more, get more. Is there any question what we mean by get more? I mean, and right. Overlay this onto the promises of you know, Islam when somebody dies in you know, in the service of jihad. What does he get? Something similar.
That's
like
right.
That. Virgins, which come free from the rival's genes. Virgins, once again.
Man, this
not two females.
Yeah. This is just 70. Everywhere, isn't it? All right.
It is. It pervades a lot of our day-to-day lives, sure.
Okay. Hey, just reading through that chapter, like, you've got me on every hook. I'm like, yeah, this is what we're doing. Yeah, this is what we're doing. Yeah, this is what we're doing. It seems to be about sex all when it comes to this stuff. And when you start looking at all the documents, when you see the canon, I don't know if they're called bulls, but in Catholicism, where they have these codes of behavior and ethics, you know, where here we go, and then the priests and everything, and you know, they're not supposed to mate or have sex, and they take these are in your book here. So canon 604. Let me read this. Canon 604. Similar, and this is the church's code of canon law. Similar to these forms of consecrated life is the order of virgins who, committed to the holy plan of following Christ more closely, are consecrated to God, you know, blah, 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 blah. And then it goes on. Like, so we've got this here, virginity. But Hector, you keep pointing out, what does an almighty God who doesn't or isn't in need of resources have to do with our sexuality, right? And us Christians or former Christians who are trying to even figure out how you're coming to all this. Now we can start pointing to all these things and be like, you know what? It's not just about chastity, whatever the hell reason that would be for anyways. It's actually an all male dominated culture, not just Christian, but Islamic as well. And this just seems to permeate through all our culture. I'll stop rambling for a minute, let you get some sound bites in.
Well, you know, looking at this another way, like some evolutionary psychologists think that marriage itself might have been a strategy to keep male alliances strong. In other words, to help each other respect each other's claims. And so, on the other hand, you know, there's some benefit to not causing a lot of social disruption by, at least among males in a society, if you want it to be cohesive, by, you know, going after each other's mating claims.
Right.
So that may be one reason that's not so on the dark side necessarily, about be chased for your husband. Mm-hmm. But again, we have contraception now. So, you know, you can even have sex with somebody else and not get pregnant because of it. Our psychology, our emotions, our sexual jealousy evolved at a time that far, far predated any form of contraception. So that doesn't really matter. It's the act of, you know, sexual jealousy is still powerful, even if there's no reproduction attached to it. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And, you know, this is completely off into left field, sort of. But there is a story, and I cannot recall it in the Bible. All you guys can cite it after the fact, where but he's having sex with a woman. This is in the Old Testament. And he pulls out, and he drops his semen on the ground instead of going inside of her. Sorry, guys.
Onan. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think his name is Onan.
And then something bad happened. Like, God did not look favorably upon that somehow. I don't know the whole story, but for some reason that came to mind. Probably because we're talking.
I want to say he kills him. I can't remember, because I actually cite that story in my upcoming book, Sex, Power, and Partisanship, coming out February 5th. I actually cite that. So,
and I don't have anything to add on to that. So, if you got something, you can throw it on there.
Well, listen, the biblical age was an incredibly terrifying time to live. And like we talked about last time, you know, a basic fact of human of coalitions is the bigger the coalition, the more powerful you are.
Yeah.
You didn't want to do anything to limit the size of the tribe. You know, so per Levirate law, you were supposed to, if your brother dies, you marry his wife and you impregnate her and you start having babies. You don't stop expanding the tribe, you know, so because doing so is a huge vulnerability. If you're a small tribe, you're going to get massacred. You know, that was the pressure in the biblical age. So you have this movement called the Quiverful movement in the US, where it's, you know, sons are like quivers in your arrows in a quiver, and yeah. And you won't be shamed when you meet the enemy at the gate. That's what comes from this Bible passage that basically says that. And those who espouse this are like, they have these Christians in America that have these insane amount of kids, you know, 15 kids, 16 kids, 20 kids. And the idea is like, we are going to overpopulate the other religions. We're going to overpopulate Islam. We're going to overpopulate. We're going to out reproduce, I should say, the atheists. And it comes from this fear of being overtaken.
And I'm very familiar. So, you know, there are Christian groups who specifically say exactly what you just said, and use that for a defense, for example, going through the 80s and other eras where overpopulation started becoming a popular idea, and some Christians were countering that with exactly what you were talking about. Yeah, but God says, you know, have all.
Yeah, but God, but the problem with that, the danger in that is we are overpopulating this planet at a stunning rate. That's one problem. And the other problem is that in societies where women aren't allowed to have choices of about their own reproduction, they're either coerced, forced, or just kind of strongly encouraged to just be baby mills. Then, you know, other rights for women tend to pitfall. Rights to vote, rights to drive.
Why? How does it go from point A to point B there?
Well, I mean, those giving women the right to go to work, to pay their own bills, you know, it gives them an out from this baby mill, basically. So women have other choices to make, and so in the most restrictive countries where women have the least amount of civil liberties, they also have the highest birth rates. Mm-hmm. So you know, that's usually pushed by men saying, "Have my children, have my children, have my children, have my children, populate my genes into the next generation."
So that would be the correlation there. In heavily male, sexually dominated cultures, women tend to have a lot of children.
So how can you go make a living for yourself when you have 15 kids to take care of? You're not getting a job unless you're a farmer or something.
And then what? So and then so the objection is when women start gaining power and gaining resources and that sort of thing, what, there's less demand on them, who women being already choosy, as we've described at the beginning of this interview, can now not only be choosy, but simply not need a man. Oh, shit, Hector, where are we going with this?
You might get a call from Jordan Peterson or something. I don't know. Well, in societies where women have more say in the matter, they tend to have less kids. You know, their focus is on quality. Their focus is on devote a lot of energy and time and nurturance to the children I have. I don't have to have, you know, 20 kids, which is medically risky too. So that's something we see. Look at Scandinavia. Like, you know, when women have a choice to reproduce, they tend to reproduce less. That's a trend we see.
Yeah. So I'm going to play something real quick. This is should be 60 seconds. And this is a friend of mine. And Hector, you were talking before about in Saudi Arabia and other Islamic majority countries where you have to have a male, she probably says it in here, but then it plays into something called a guardianship law. Let's take a look at this real quick. We'll be right back in 60 seconds.
Guardianship law, I feel like it has so much to do with that.
What is guardianship law?
Guardianship law is only for women.
Why does a woman need a guardian?
Well, it's really because of the culture, but there's also another hadith, which is a prophet saying, I don't know if it's strong, but that saying said that a woman have to have a permission from Wali Amr, which is a guardian. But the culture, the Arab culture, and in Saudi Arabia in particular, that's just how they always have been doing it. Like, since I was born, I had my father who was my guardian. And when I came here, just because I had the scholarship, one of the requirements for me to have the scholarship is to have a guardian.
All right, let me see the tag. But what do you think about that, Hector?
That's exactly what I'm talking about, you know, and what I have endeavored to do is explain the why. You know, that's the thing about the science that I love. It's the evolutionary science. It explains the why. What is the purpose of all this? What's the reason for all this? Yes, these things exist. And sometimes when people get asked, like, I don't even know why, you know, because it's so beneath the radar of our consciousness. Mm-hmm. But that's why. It has such explanatory and it's simple. It's a simple explanation that has a lot of validity on so many levels.
Yeah. Let's get into one more thing. Infanticide. What the hell's going on?
Okay. That's one of the darker subjects that I cover. You see infanticide in a lot of different species. You see infanticide in primate species, often when an alpha is dethroned and another male takes his position at the apex of the hierarchy. So what that alpha usually does, the new alpha usually does, is goes around and kills all the infants of the troop. So what happens is that sends the females into estrus more quickly. So he can mate with them. That takes competitors for his offspring out of the gene pool. There's an advantage to that. There's an evolutionary advantage to that. It's dark. It's sad. It's scary. But there's an evolutionary logic to that. So when we look at men, homicides against children is way disproportionately across the world, way disproportionately committed against stepchildren. It's the same dynamic.
Wow.
Rid the gene pool of the rivals for your children, And so you see this also in the Bible, and just that passage that I told you about before, you know, kill all the boys, but save the women for yourself. The boys are rivals.
Let me just read that real quick out of Numbers. Numbers 31, 17 through 18. Now, therefore, kill every male among the little ones, and kill every woman who has known a man by lying with him. But all the young girls who have not known a man by lying with him, keep alive for yourselves. Now, there's going to be some fundamental Christians who jerk back against that. But this is important and plays into the utility of infanticide. How?
Well, look, this is happening today. I mean, Boko Haram, ISIS, that's what they have done. They tear into these villages, slaughter all the men, march all the boys out, spray them with machine gun fire, and take all the women as sexual slaves. They did the ISIS did it to the Yazidi women in northern Iraq. You know, this goes on. It comes from a very primitive place, but it gets sacralized. Right, it gets sacralized when you see it in scriptures, like you see in Numbers, and so it's hard to challenge, especially when you see these commands or these stories, in a society that does not allow you to question them, because questioning them is heresy. Well, of course if you want to retain that privilege, you're going to say questioning it is heresy. You can't do that. It goes against the designs of the most powerful male in the universe. You can't question it. Right. You can't question my privilege.
You might be the victim of infanticide next.
You might be killed. So it's all there. We just have to look at it honestly. And see where it comes from, and this is the value of evolutionary science. It tells you where it all comes from. This is where we have to fight ridiculously in this country to teach evolution in public schools, because of what it can tell us about the darker sides of humanity. If we don't study this, we're just more prone to just perpetuating these things thoughtlessly. If we do study them, we can make more conscious choices.
Okay, so that sounds like if we got away from creationism, if we got away from teaching religion as a method of informing us and went to other things, let's say like evolutionary psychology to inform us on the way we behave and why, and how that could maybe give us some perspective on better ways to move forward, then we as a society would be better. And probably have just vastly great, more social progress than what we presently have now, or are in risk of if we keep promoting creationism, teaching, that sort of stuff. Is that what you're saying?
There's research on this, Arael. I mean, so there are measures, there are societal health measures that look at all kinds of things. I may have mentioned this in the last talk we had, I can't recall, but teenage pregnancy, gross national product, oh my gosh, access to healthcare, educational level, access, internet access. The healthiest societies across all these measures, and what I just mentioned is just a fraction of them, they tend to be the least religious. So there's some evidence of that, objective evidence.
Yeah.
So we can build more. We can build healthier societies, and those societies too don't give absolute privilege to male reproductive prerogatives. So women have a lot of social services where they don't have to rely on men. In places where women are forbidden to work, they have to submit themselves to male reproductive interests. What other choice do they have? Where do they go? It's not like they can get a job and support themselves. They're not allowed to work.
Sounds like we're trying to move from 1950s America to the current movement where we have now. Where we've spent decades.
Or from the chimpanzee troop.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go. You talk about power being with men, and I know we just kind of got off the infanticide thing real quick. But if you're a Christian, these stories should stand out to you with infanticide. Basically, God is in favor of infanticide. And you might say, because they deserved it, they disobeyed God for so long and everything. That's fine. That's cool. Until you happen to be born into that culture or civilization, like Egypt, where people are just being people, and then God says every firstborn son of Egypt will die, from the firstborn son of the Pharaoh who sits on the throne to the throne to the firstborn son of the female slave, who, man, she must have really did something bad, who is at her handmill, and all the firstborn of the cattle as well. Man, talk about resources. There we go. If you don't obey God, he'll take your resources too. Not only that, from you, but from all your people. There will be a loud wailing throughout Egypt, worse than there has ever been or ever will be again. My God will do that to you if you don't give us everything we want. Exodus 11, 5 through 6. So, infanticide, yeah.
Infanticide, it's old. It's very old. It's a very old behavior. And it serves male reproductive interests. And, you know, in saying all this stuff, I mean, I just want to point out that if not all men are going to enact this stuff, so many men like hear something like this, and this is repugnant to them. Like, mm-hmm. I will fight to prevent that from happening.
Yeah.
You know, so in saying all of these things, it's not to demonize men in any way, because there are men who would give their lives to make sure that doesn't happen to our society or to liberate other people from that kind of situation.
Yeah.
But it's definitely part of our psychology, and I think we have an ethical imperative to understand it, however scary it might be. I mean, a lot of people freak out when you start talking about, we have these impulses to do terrible things to one another, because they think that means that we're doomed to doing that. And that's just not the case. You know, we have the ability to make better choices. I think we have to understand these things first and critically evaluate how all these evolutionary imperatives get embedded in secular governance and in the structures of our religions.
Well, I'm going to say something that you kind of already just said. I would like to read your argument from your chapter, Sexual Dominance from Apes to Men to Gods. Seems to be kind of your nail down sentence in the whole chapter. I argue, Hector, that sexually repressive behaviors and their representative doctrines and ideologies are rooted in mental architecture designed for navigating the social world of our primitive ancestors. So it just sounds like this is handed down to us, that psychology and whatever is being handed down to us, that was meant to deal with the world then, or rather, that's how we dealt with the world then. I'm not sure how to use that. And we're still dealing with it now and trying to figure out, is there a better way, isn't there? Or if we're not even aware of it, we won't figure it out. I wanted to read that. That was a very clear statement.
Yeah, absolutely. We live in a different world than, fortunately, we're smart enough to find ways to live in a world that is not as savage and as precarious as those in which we evolved. I mean, we died from starvation. We died from simple infections all the time. We've managed to build the capacity to remove starvation from the human experience. We don't need to fight each other for resources. We don't need to raid the rival tribe and take all their goods and, you know, slaughter all their firstborn sons and take their women or take their cows or whatever. We don't need to do that anymore. But yeah. So you're right. We comprise this world that we've created in an eye blink of time in our evolutionary history. This is just a fraction. We still have this architecture designed for a very different place, and we have to understand it.
Yeah. One more thing. This will be our last thing. God doesn't just want us to be physically chaste or virgins or consecrated to him physically. He also wants that in a different way. He doesn't want us committing just physical adultery, but he also doesn't want us committing spiritual adultery. Hector, that was your cue again.
Yeah, spiritual adultery. Sure. Like,
that's how far this is taken in religion.
And then sure.
All of that is used as puzzle pieces to put together and be like, in no way can you defect from this ideology, whether by your physical practice or the longings and yearnings of your thoughts, your mind, your heart. Like, don't even think about it. Because God is a jealous God. You know,
God is a jealous God. And like we talked about last time, you know, that serves a militaristic purpose. You know, you have a society that worships a lot of different gods. It's hard to mobilize them as one force to defend against the encroaching enemy, you know. And that's the pressures that we talked about last time that led to the monotheistic God that was very jealous of other gods.
Mm-hmm. And consolidating power and bringing everything down to basically one thing. Yeah.
Sure. And if you're going to do that for the practical political purpose of amassing power, you do that based on the psychology that we have developed to understand the primate hierarchy and seeding, you know, dealing with a sexually jealous alpha. The same thing, you know, it's kind of, so you know, in religion, those two are often confounded. You know, they're often put together. If you spiritual adultery, if you give your heart to any other religion, it's like committing adultery. Yeah. You know. So
all right, there you go. Hey, one more question. It's funny. Have you ever heard of a nut sack?
No.
Yeah.
All no. Right.
Well, I'll let you find that out. But you had talked about something where primates destroy the genitalia of other primates. It just took me back to my high school years.
You cannot say, have you heard of a nut slap and leave it like that. You got to explain the nut slap.
Well, since you said that primates will, especially like I think chimpanzees or maybe baboons, I don't know. destroy the genitalia of other males. I'm thinking, and then there was this comment in your chapter where human primates, humans don't really do that. Like, we kind of do with like circumcision and some Islamic law, but you know.
No, contrarily, I make the case that we do that a lot. I mean, that is a common way to like it. Yeah. Like in warfare, emasculating the enemy, that's a common practice across all kinds of military campaigns.
Gotcha. And I wrote down there, I'm like, has he heard of a nut slap? ? And that's basically where you're just going around with your friends. And maybe it's a friendly way of doing it. But I'm like, it got me to thinking, I'm like, wait a minute, all those times, a nut slap is just when you throw your hand down and like, bam, just hit somebody's nuts real quick. And you know, it's done between friends. But then you
be
got,
careful if we ever hang out.
I don't do it. I mean, I did. But,
wear a cup or something.
Yeah, and it got me thinking. I was trying to kick in my evolutionary psychological mindset from Hector Garcia. I'm like,
to the nuts lap, huh? Oh man. Yeah. Well,
were they trying to
maybe you can write a paper on that.
Yeah. All right, Hector. You and I started late. We've gone over a little bit, so we're not going to stay for an after show. Okay, we'll just end the show, and then you can hang up. But for everybody else, I know you want to see it again. Number one, we're going to have Hector on again. We're going to keep going through this great material. And if you like it, give us a thumbs up, subscription, and all that other stuff. And we'll keep bringing this stuff to you. We're going to have Hector on again. But before we do our closeout, yes, I will play that sexy video for everybody again, to leave you with the image of how we market to ourselves, how we idealize mate guarding, was it, Hector? Or, you know, basically everything.
All that, it's the all number that strategy. Men's desire for, you're going to show the Axe deodorant spray commercial, right? Yeah.
Yep. All right, you guys get to see that. Hey, thanks for joining the show, everybody, over in the live stream. Thanks, Hector, for being on. I'm going to play this video, but before I do, Hector, tell everybody goodbye.
Goodbye, everybody. Pleasure.
Richard, so many people have experiences, and so many people say, if it wasn't for Jesus, or if it wasn't for God, or if it wasn't for Allah,
right.
You know, and they will tell you, and they stake their life on it, they stake their reputation on it, they're passionate, they're enthusiastic, you know, they live half their lives telling this to others.
Yeah,
so are you telling me that if somebody just reflected for 5 minutes, they would say, well, all science,
but no, they were not reflecting 5 minutes, because what you're talking about, like the whole, like all these lucky things that happened to me must come from God, right? To understand why that's not logical requires really understanding statistics and probability theory, right? And that's not easy, right? You can't just do that in 5 minutes. If you haven't learned that stuff, it's going to take longer than 5 minutes for you to learn it. But it's another example of looking at the big picture, understanding, like, if you look at in terms of just probability, obviously, if there's no God, lucky chances and good luck things are going to happen to you anyway, right? But it's hard to get to the point of realizing that, yeah, and when you're looking at there's 6 billion people on the planet, that means if you say some lucky thing happens to you and it's 1 billion to 1 odds against, well, actually, it's happening to 6 people because, right, 6 billion people. So these sort of incredible good luck events are definitely going to happen just on sheer chance alone. But to get to the point where you understand that and realize, oh, okay, so then I need to be able to distinguish what is just lucky outcome and what is something that actually is a supernaturally caused thing. And then, of course, that's even after you've eliminated the stuff that's not actually a lucky outcome, but is actually science. So someone will say, like, God cured my cancer. And well, actually, you had a whole bunch of medical treatment. Right? Like, science cured your cancer. It wasn't God. But even if you eliminate that, like, people realize, like, no, actually, science is doing what you're talking about. You still have these chance coincidences. You have to sort of, how do you tell the difference between just being lucky and God doing something for you? And if you don't sit back and reflect and think, oh, actually, I don't know how to tell the difference between those two things, then you can't make that argument, right? And so, but that's again of stepping back and looking at the big picture, which most people don't do.
For those who think beyond boundaries, where is your pride?